This video was sponsored by Babbel, one of the world's best language learning apps. It never occurred to me that one day people might want to hear me speak in a foreign language. That was not the plan when I studied physics. I've meanwhile subscribed to like a dozen English pronunciation channels and spent a lot of time with the online dictionary replaying words, so much so that at this point I think my channel should really be called Sabine Learns English. Inevitably, I'm now giving English lectures to my English friend who really doesn't know anything about English. But then I also don't know anything about German other than speaking it. And because looking into English pronunciation clicked some things into place that I kind of knew but never consciously realized, we'll start the new year with a not too brain-intensive video on the difference between American and British English. And that's what we'll talk about today. I spent some years in the United States and some more in Canada, and when I came back to Europe, my English sounded like this.
So in normal standard quantum mechanics, what would happen is that whenever the particles get measured, there's a 50% chance that it gets thrown out.
I then acquired a British friend. His name is Tim Palmer, and you already know him as the singing climate scientist.
It'll get warmer, that we can show. But it might get cooler, you just never know.
Tim also has an interest in quantum mechanics, and he'd get very offended when I'd say quantum mechanics. And since I'm the kind of person who overthinks everything, I can now exactly tell you what makes British people sound British. But since my own pronunciation is clearly of no help, I asked him to read you some sentences. And to represent the American pronunciation, I asked the astrophysicist Brian Keating, who kindly agreed. Before we listen to their speech samples, I want to be clear that, of course, there are many different accents in both the UK and in the US, and it's not like there's only one right pronunciation. But the differences that I'll be talking about are quite general, as I'm sure you'll notice in a moment. Now, first of all, there are many words which are just different in North America and in the UK. Trucks, lorries, cookies, biscuits, trash, rubbish, gasoline, petrol, and so on. There are also some words which are used in both languages but don't mean the same thing, such as rubber or fanny. Just be careful with those. And then there are words which are the same but are pronounced somewhat differently, like tomato and tomato, or vitamin and vitamin. Or they have a somewhat different emphasis, like vaccine, which in American English has the emphasis on the second syllable, whereas in British English it's vaccine, with the emphasis on the first syllable. But besides that, there are also some overall differences in the pronunciation. The probably most obvious one is the T's. Listen to this first example from Brian and Tim and pay attention to those T's.
Quantum mechanics isn't as complicated as they say.
Quantum mechanics isn't as complicated as they say.
In American English, it's quite common to use tap T's that sound kind of like D's, better, complicated, or kind of mumble over the T's altogether, as in quantum mechanics. In British English, the T's tend to be much clearer pronounced, better, complicated, quantum mechanics. While this is, I believe, the difference that's the easiest to pick up on, it's not overall the biggest difference. I think the biggest difference is probably that a lot of R's are silent in British English, which means they're not pronounced at all. There are a lot of words in which this happens, like the word word, which in American English would be word. Let's hear the next sample and pay attention to the R's.
The first stars were born about 100 million years after the Big Bang.
The first stars were born about 100 million years after the Big Bang.
In American English, you have first, stars, born. In British English, none of those has an R, so it's first, stars, born. The Brits also drop those R's at the end of words.
The plumber wasn't any less clever than the professor.
The plumber wasn't any less clever than the professor.
Plumber, plumber, clever, clever, professor, professor. That sound, which the Brits leave at the end of an ER word, is called the schwa sound, and its phonetic spelling is an E turned by 180 degrees. It's the most common sound in British English, and it goes like this. That's it. In case you think that schwa sounds kind of German, that's because it is kind of German. It goes back to a Hebrew word, but the term was introduced by the German linguist Johann Schmeller in 1821 to describe how Germans actually pronounced words rather than writing them. The schwa sound is all over the place in German too. For example, at the end of words like Sonne, Treppe, or Donaudampfschifffahrtsgesellschaftskapitänsmütze. But let's come back to English and talk a little bit more about those R's. Not all R's are silent in British English. You keep them at the beginning of words, right, but you also keep them between two vowels. For example, wherever in American English has two R's. In British English, you drop the one at the end, but keep the one in the middle, wherever. The R dropping is actually easy to learn once you've wrapped your head around it, because there are general rules for it. Personally, I find the British pronunciation easier because the English R's don't exist in German, so if you can get rid of them, great. Okay, but just dropping the R's won't make you sound like the Queen. There are a few more things. Let's hear another sample. This time, pay attention to the vowels.
I thought I caught a cold after I fell into the water.
I thought I caught a cold after I fell into the water.
So you hear the two different T's in water again, but more prominently you hear that the British use or, where the Americans use a sound that's closer to an er, water, water. This one is also quite easy to learn because it's a general thing. Somewhat more difficult is the next one. Again, pay attention to the vowels.
You have got this wrong. It's probably not possible.
You've got this wrong. It's probably not possible.
What you hear there is that some of the us in American English are us in British English. Those two sounds have a different phonetic spelling. The a is spelled like this, and the o is the upside down of this. The difference is most obvious in the word not, which in American English sounds more like not. Same thing with possible, which becomes possible. And I did expect Brian to say probably, but he pronounced it probably, which is interesting. As I said, there's a lot of regional variations on the pronunciation. I found this one rather difficult to learn because there's another a sound for which this shift does not happen, and that has a phonetic spelling which looks somewhat like a big lambda. Conversation turns to conversation, consciously into consciously, but company stays company. God turns to God, but nothing stays nothing. Yes, that is confusing. And in confusing, the pronunciation doesn't change because the first syllable is unstressed, which means that the o becomes a schwa. Yes, that's also confusing. One final difference. This took me a long time to notice, but once you know it, it's really obvious. English famously has a lot of diphthongs. Those are combinations of two vowels. For example, I, that's actually two vowels, A and E, I, or A as in take or baby, that's an E and an E, A, take. Most of those diphthongs are pronounced pretty much the same in British and American English, except for the O as in no. In American English, that's more like an O, whereas in British English, you start close to an E, O, no, no. Only, only, and so on. Let's hear how Brian and Tim pronounce this.
I don't know how slowly it will go.
I don't know how slowly it will go.
As I said, once you know it, it's entirely obvious, isn't it? And if you want to sound Canadian, you keep the American O, but use the British O for the ow. So, out becomes out, about becomes about, without, without. But be careful, once you got that O in your about, it's really hard to get rid of. The shift from the American O to the British O is also confusing because many dictionaries use the same phonetic spelling for both sounds. And also, you don't do it if there's an L coming after the O. So, for example, pole doesn't become pole. No. So don't do it if an L is coming up, except there's an exception to the exception, which is folks. And that's it, folks. Next week, we're back to talking about science. Did you know, by the way, that German almost became the official language in the United States? You did? Well, that's an urban legend. It never happened. The USA doesn't even have an official language. It's just that English is the most widely spoken one. Many thanks to Tim and Brian for their recordings, and many thanks also to Kate Middleton from Speak My Language for helping with this video. This video was sponsored by Babbel. I have to admit that what I like most about science, after the research itself of course, is that it brings together people from all over the planet, people from different backgrounds who speak different languages. Now, I've never been particularly good at languages, that's why I studied physics, but when I travel, I like to know at least a few words in the local language. I certainly wish I'd spoken Spanish when I was in Barcelona, and the taxi driver spoke neither English, nor German, nor French, and then dropped me off at the wrong end of the city. True story. So, be smarter than me. Babbel is a language app which makes it super easy to learn a new language or freshen up what you learned at school. With Babbel, it takes just a few weeks to learn the basics of a new language. The best thing is that you can do it when you want, and a lesson doesn't take more than 10 minutes, so exactly the right thing for busy people like you and me. The lessons on Babbel all come with little quizzes, so you can check right away if you understood it all correctly. And along the way, you learn something about the culture and traditions.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Yo soy Lucía Martínez.
Yo soy Lucía Martínez.
If you don't yet have a New Year's resolution, how about learning a new language? You can now get 65% off your subscription if you use our special offer. The link is just below this video. Thanks for watching. See you next week.